Namaste. For today's reflection, we can take up the law of karma. Someone has requested about it. As we know, the law of karma, as is popularly known, is that when we do good, we get, as a result, reward, very often material rewards in another life. And when we do bad deeds, then we get punishments, very often material punishments, meaning thereby a good person who has done good deeds is born in a rich family, and a poor, bad person who has done evil deeds is born in a poor family with very difficult conditions. This is a very crude way of looking at things, because it means the divine also values riches. So therefore, if he has to punish someone, he makes someone poor. It means all the poor people have been punished by the divine, and the rich people have been blessed by him. It also raises another question, that, well, when we really look at the history, some of the great saints, we see that they were born in very meager, modest surroundings. I mean, Sant Raidas was a person who was, mending the shoes. And many others, equally some saints may be born in rich family, Mirabai and Bhule Shah, for example. Kabir, very modest family. Even apparently an orphan, born in the family of those who were weavers. So it means they had done some sin, therefore they were born as in poor family. And if so, how come there was a radical conversion and they rose to sainthood? If we take outer difficulties as an index, then it's very difficult to understand how come the Pandavas, they must have been great sinners to be deprived of their kingdom again and again. And if so, how come they were born with such beautiful inner nature? Equally, Duryodhana must have been a saint to be born as a prince, live as a prince and die as a prince, in spite of being full of ambition, suicidal ideas, and hatred and jealousies. So obviously something we have missed in terms of understanding the law of karma. So what really the law of karma is, to start with, it means that whatever energy of thought or feeling or action or even will we have released in this atmosphere, in this world, has its course. Now, its course means it will have its repercussions, actions upon others, etc., etc. And then it tends to return back to us, meaning thereby if we have released an energy of bad will. Now this bad will go and it will harm people, not because they have done some bad karma. It just happened that they were around us, and for whatever reason, now we'll come to that a little later, somebody may fall ill because of our bad will, and we may not even realize. Sometimes there is something called as an ignorant goodwill which can harm. And she says that people are full of fear and therefore they advise all kinds of things medically, but actually they are harming people because they are stealing away faith and feeling fear. So ignorant goodwill can also harm. So any energy which is released into the world, thought, feelings, actions, will, impulsions, passions, they tend to take a course and come back to us. Now, very often, most of us are not really organized beings, and all these energies are very small. It's like effervescent. Say a small little water, if we keep in a pan and set it to fire, there is a little bit of vapor. So most of these energies really come out and they are like little wishes which fritter away as soon as they come out, like bubbles. So they really speaking, they just come out and they drop dead, as it were, very soon. And obviously there is no repercussion, except that when we repeatedly wish for something and it's not fulfilled, we are frustrated more and more. So there we have to master our thoughts and feelings and wishes, understand the law, subtle laws of this world, how it operates, rather than think it is some karma. it obviously will bring frustration, because maybe we are wishing something which in the nature of things, or because of our present disposition, constitutions or conditions of life, may not come so easily. It may come if we spend a whole lifetime of probably labor on it, but we have to think whether it is worth the labor. But this is the fate of most of the energies. Then there are contradictory wills. They crisscross with each other and cancel each other. It's like the person who wants to achieve something but also is doubting. So they are contradicting each other, and therefore because of fear and effort mixing with each other, he's not able to get anything. Again, no law of karma. Or it may go and hit somebody, some bad will or a good will which we have released in the world does good to people, and somewhere their hearts begin to feel that here is a center of a human being who is full of goodwill, and they begin to respond. Nature begins to respond, creation begins to respond in innovative ways, and this goodwill comes back to us manifold, because that's how the nature of the universe it multiplies. It has nothing to do with after death and some other life, reward and punishment. It's the natural consequence. Equally, when we do a bad will, have a bad will, after some time people know, they start shunning our company, they stay away from us, and we think they are shunning our company because, you know, that's how I am destined, nobody is my friend. Well, nobody is my friend only because I am too full of myself. You know, there are people who are all the time complaining, grudging, only talking about themselves, and after a time friends tend to walk away because people want to be heard rather than all the time hear you. So these are very simple, subtle laws of life, and we don't really need to bring in the aspect of reward and punishment, which we really don't need to bring at all. So in our life itself, we will experience that when we are full of bad will, full of, you know, state of division, hatred, jealousy, we suffer. Not because there is a God out there who has to punish us, simply because it narrows us, and when it narrows us, it cuts away the joy of creation from us. You know, the joy that a flower feels, the joy that a river feels, the joy trees feel, the joy even the animal kind feels, we are cut off because we are closed only in ourselves, me, my thoughts. So it makes our consciousness narrow and narrow, and eventually we are cut off from the vast joy which is circulating in the universe, and we begin to suffer. We are unhappy. Not because anybody is punishing us for some past life, but simply because our state of consciousness is such that, you know, people who grudge, not only this, we become prone to the attacks of adverse forces which are looking for those who are constantly complaining. So when we are constantly complaining, these forces are on the lookout. How do they push us? They make us more and more angry, frustrated, depressed. So now they think, here is the person who is always full of complaints, or my good candidate for me. So there are consequences of that, and we become more and more angry, frustrated and unhappy. Equally, when we are full of goodwill, then there is an expansion of the heart. We are having love for all the creatures, for human beings, for you know, for friends and family and the creatures, the animals, the plants, and eventually toward the whole world. So then when we live in that vastness, very naturally we are experiencing delight, not again because of some karmas, but simply because we have released beautiful energies, and by that we have grown vast. So when we grow vast, we will experience delight. Pain and suffering tends to vanish. So this is the natural law. So what about next life? Do we carry something in the next life? Well, what we carry for the next life is unfinished learning curve. So karma essentially is energy, its consequence, but not the way of reward punishment. We learn. This is the process. Say schooling. We release certain energies and then we learn, and through all experiences, pain and pleasure, the soul is growing. So what's happening behind the scene? Outwardly we experience pleasure and pain. The ego self feels good or bad. You know, takes it as reward or punishment, but the soul grows through everything. So if you take the soul's standpoint, everything is a grace, everything is beautiful, everything is wonderful, all is a grace, even what we call as pain, what we call as suffering, to the Pandavas, to Draupadi, it's all ultimately a grace. So we can look at it from that standpoint. But since we don't have access to the soul, mainly because we have not tried it and we live in the ego self, that's why we have all these theories of good and bad, pleasure and pain, etc., etc. All these theories are ways to fill up our ignorance. So there are even paths towards God where they talk about going to God, but these theories are there to explain all the misery upon earth. But this is not the reason for misery. Misery is simply because the nature of matter is imperfect. Doesn't matter, even when there is a divine being who takes a material body, he will experience trouble because matter is imperfect. He may be a very good human being, but if a thorn pricks him, he will have pain. Not because in some previous life he had pricked somebody with a thorn. If he doesn't do that, there will be some other illness, something or the other. So we have a tendency to fill our ignorance with all these fantastic theories because they justify God, they create a neat system, and the mind likes to keep a neat system. But there is a neat system, there is a wisdom that operates, but not in the way of a fixed belief system. So how does it operate? Karma is about learning and growth. Constantly we are moving forward. There is nothing like, oh, I was a human being in this life, next life I'll be born. You know, if I have heard somebody's then all the spies should be born as a lizard or a rat or this or that. God knows fantastic things. It's impossible because once the psychic has developed to take on a human body, it can't really go into an animal body because animals don't have an individual psyche. They have a spirit of the species. And the proof is that animals don't, there's not much variation between one animal of a certain kind and another. Two dogs, by and large, they will have canines, they have similar tendencies. Then cats will have similar tendencies. Some differences will be there, but not radical changes. An elephant doesn't become non-vegetarian. But human beings have a individualized psychic embryo and eventually a psychic being. So we make choices. We are very individualized because of the individual psyche. So there is no going back. Karma is about growth. So it's a growth by experience. So there are certain things we have experienced in this life, but they are unfinished learning curves, so we need to experience them. Certain things we have completed, certain things we have not finished the lesson. So we sleep over, which is death, we wake up and we complete that curve to whatever extent. If we are slow learners, it will take many lives. If we are quick learners, then it takes less life, lesser number of life. So what is given to us is to learn slowly or to learn rapidly. This is given to man. So karmic theory is essentially about learning, and this learning takes place over many lives, and through this learning, through these experiences, many experiences which outwardly we say as pleasant and unpleasant or happy or sorrow, inwardly through all of them, as Shobindu says in Savitri, it drinks, speaking of the psychic being, it drinks experience like a strengthening wine. So we grow through that, and the psychic being grows through that till it reaches a point and it has learned the lessons it had to learn during the high school phase. So this learning goes on, let's say, through certain number of lives, which is high school degree, higher secondary. Now it has a choice. It's out of the school. So it can either no coming to school, no entering into the avagaman of life and death, bad choice, because it means no perfection. Or it may say, no, I have passed, school of ignorance is over, but now I want to learn something much deeper. So it takes a spiritual life and enters into graduation, goes into deeper sense, spiritual states through this path or that path. And then even as a master, it can unite with one being of the higher worlds and come back into the school, but now to teach and not to learn really, because basic learning is over. Or a better option, the best option, as Sri Aurobindo gives us now, it can engage in the integral manifestation of the divine, means completely expressing the divine will in creation, and not just come back for teaching a few more souls to walk away from earth to escape, but in participating and engaging in the divine will's fulfillment in creation. So then one is the third option, that one is a free being, but one comes here in the realm of ignorance. Obviously when one comes, things stick to the person, but essentially to be an instrument of the divine and eventually to participate in the divine manifestation and the transformation process. So friends, karma is not about reward and punishment. Let's get rid of that crude idea. There is something called as action and consequence, but it's not about getting this or that material object, but it is about learning through our actions by experiencing inner states of joy or inner state of disturbance, inner state of calm and wideness and delight, or inner states in which we experience shriveled up, narrow, small, petty, miserable, because our actions have been either very wide, unselfish, or extremely selfish and narrow. So this is one kind of action and consequences. Sometimes the energies of nature and universe hit back at us, and a tyrant does get hit back by energies which he has released in the world, and he may be assassinated, he may be brutally killed, etc., etc. Now these are the processes by which nature maintains a balance. And finally, karma is about learning and growth of the psychic being through manifold experiences of life. And if we don't engage in action, we will not grow. So that's why Shri Krishna says that you must engage in action. In fact, you can't do away without action. Even if you sit quietly, it's a choice you have made. Even inertia is an action at one level. Choice of inaction is an action. We have chosen to stay away from a field of action, which is fair enough. But this choice will bring its own learning. We may use the word consequences, but this learning is about the growth of the soul. It has nothing to do with being born in a rich family or a poor family, for God's sake, or being born with, outer circumstances and situations. But inwardly, yes, a person who has really led a beautiful life is born with certain capacities which can help him, which are the natural expression of the psychic, the soul state which is developed. And these capacities the person can put to use at the divine service if he wills. Now these capacities need not only be intelligence, because we think capacity only about intelligence. It's not about even reason. There can be a developed intelligence if that is required for the instrumentation, or like in Vivekananda's case, but also a capacity which is emotional. Take for instance Sri Ramakrishna Paramahans. He's a genius of emotions, or a capacity of tremendous passion and will, like Arjuna and Bhima, who have come for divine work, or even a physical capacity. So all these are different capacities which may come because the psychic being wants to engage with a certain line of growth. So this is how we have to look at karma and get rid of these small little ideas. And whatever I'm saying is, of course, based on basically Mother and Sri Aurobindo's. They are not my own thoughts, but I can say that yes, they can be confirmed in the experience of anyone who walks the integral path. Thank you.